Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is a disease of scarring of the lungs, and idiopathic means we don't really know what causes that scarring, but it is a devastating disease. From my point of view, a lot of what's out there in terms of what we understand about IPF has some real limitations. So single center reports, so they have small numbers of patients. There may be biases around how specific centers practice. So while it's important to get those reports and that data out there, that knowledge may not be generalizable. And then we have clinical trials, and there's been really a lot of growth in clinical trials in the IPF space in the DCRI, and Kevin Anstrom actually led some of that work coordinating IPFnet. And those trials are really helpful to answer a specific question, but they also have certain rigid inclusion and exclusions that limit the kinds of patients that are in those studies. So what we really wanted to do was get a better sense of everybody out there with the disease. And that means older patients, sicker patients, early onset patients, and understand their natural history. The other things we wanted to do that the registry was really well suited to address was have prospective longitudinal follow-up of the patients. And we were very fortunate through our collaboration with Boehringer Ingelheim, who's sponsoring the project, to really build in many years of follow-up. So most of these patients will be following 3, 4, 5 years after the onset of their disease to really understand what are the clinical predictors of how they do. And then there were two other aspects that we built into the registry. One was we were really interested in not just the medical outcomes, but the patient-centered outcomes. So we've built in a variety of quality of life instruments. As a clinician, when I see patients with IPF, frequently it's cough. They don't care that their pulmonary function's lower than it was last week or 6 months ago, but they say, "Doctor, what can you do about this cough?" And I really wanted to understand how that cough impacts on the quality of life. And so we have a variety of instruments to help us understand that, because if we understand from a patient point of view what's most impairing to them, then we can design treatments to improve their quality of life. And that in and of itself is important. And then the other component was, with this serial prospective clinical data collection, we really wanted to build in biological samples. If we don't have good treatments, we need to do research, we need to discover treatments, and having DNA and RNA and blood and serum will let us define, explore biomarkers, and maybe even discover new disease mechanisms that can guide us in terms of the next generation of treatments that hopefully will be more effective. But now we've started to dig a little deeper, and we're starting to ask some interesting questions. For example, when we look at the guidelines around IPF patients and who and when they should be referred for lung transplant, which is probably the only life-extending therapy we have right now. I mentioned we have no effective medical therapy for IPF. We do have lung transplant in selected patients that can add a number of years to their lives. We found that the referrals to lung transplant were low, and it's relatively underutilized, even in patients who meet all of the age and other criteria that might suggest that would be reasonable. So we want to better understand that. Another observation is only about half of the patients are on one of the two approved therapies. So again, you know, we've talked about how some of those therapies have side effects, and they don't necessarily cure the disease, they slow the progression, but that's all we've got right now. So we're sort of surprised and also trying to understand how and why therapies are disseminated in practice or why not. And so I think we're already starting to see some interest practice patterns that we don't completely understand, but as we start to understand that, maybe we can do things like the cardiologist did around how to manage acute MIs and the use of simple things like aspirin to help disseminate the knowledge we have around the use of lung transplant, the use of approved medications, and how to maybe ensure the right patients are getting those therapies.